Krishnayana Hasari Phalada Aditya.
Sure.
peace you reconcile the heights and the depths. Now we ask you to accept the fragrance of our incense and establish peace among all nations on the earth and among the children of your church. Extend the right hand of your mercy upon us and upon our departed, that we may glorify you, your Father and your Holy Spirit forever.
First hoped in Christ, in him you also who have heard heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, and have believed in him, were sealed with the promised Holy Spirit, which is the first installment of our inheritance towards redemption as God's possession in the praise of his glory. Praise be to God always.
Alleluia. Alleluia.
My soul magnifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God my Savior.
Continual repetition of the theme of God who desires to come
and meet John. It's in the prayers for the beginning of the Mass also. The desire of God incarnate to meet the last of the prophets of the Old Testament. So what we have in the meeting of Elizabeth and Mary is the meeting of the Old Covenant and the New Covenant. And this giving of the Holy Spirit as the first gift, which was referenced by St. Paul in his letters. This down payment, literally the word means in the Greek, of the Spirit of God given to us, of God's divine love, which is a pledge for the future. And so the reference is God's desire to come to the town of Ein Karim, to visit his prophet John, and to fill him with the Holy Spirit, and as the prayers say, baptizing in him in the womb of his mother, cleansing of him of all blemish, so that the child who is born to Elizabeth 3 months from now, that we will celebrate next Sunday, next week, will be free from all sin, and will be cleansed and in the state of grace, even on the day of his birth already. So there is a covenant which has been silenced, that we saw through Zechariah 2 weeks ago, because the covenant is coming to its fulfillment. And therefore these two come to meet in the hill country of Judea. So I mentioned the town that is there, the churches that we have that commemorate this event, are in a small town, which is called Ein Karim. Ein Karim at the time was a separate town. It's about 5 miles west of Jerusalem. At this point, it's just part of the cosmopolitan area, the metropolitan area of Jerusalem. And it appears that Zechariah had two households, two homes. One in town, and there has been built the Church of the Nativity of John the Baptist. And then this church, which is known as the Church of the Visitation, outside the town where Our Lady met Elizabeth. Apparently then, Zechariah not only had a house in town, he also had his camp. And during those trimesters, those first trimesters, she went to camp. I don't know if she had a beautiful pond, but she had a camp. Now, I know she had a beautiful pond, I've been there. So there's just hills. So we are much more blessed by having ponds in Maine. But this is where the Mother of God arrives to meet her relative. Now there's a detail here which is not mentioned in the Gospel, but I want to throw out to you for a couple of weeks from now, we'll consider it again. It just says that after the message came to from Gabriel to Our Lady, that she left in haste and went into the hill country of Judea. And then after the birth of John, we're told she returns to Nazareth. Now it talks about her in the singular, but it is almost impossible to imagine that a 16-year-old girl made a 3-day, 4-day journey down to Ein Karim, basically Jerusalem, by herself through the hostile territory of Samaria on her own. And so it's almost certain that Joseph, her husband, also accompanied with her and was there for those 3 months. He's not mentioned, but it's completely impossible, especially in that day and age, to imagine an unchaperoned young wife to go by herself through hostile territory. And so there's an aspect, whether it's with or without Joseph. Personally, I think that Joseph went with her, and we'll talk about that in a couple of weeks' time. So when she arrives, of course, she greets her cousin, and we have all this commotion going on. The child who starts bouncing around in the womb of his mother, 6 months old already, bouncing around. And that Elizabeth herself, we are told, is filled with the Holy Spirit. She herself is also sanctified and transformed by the mere presence of the Mother of God in her home. This is an aspect, in fact, it's mentioned in our readings for Ramsho, is that Our Lady's intent always is to bring Jesus to others. And so in coming to her cousin's house, that presence already transforms Elizabeth by grace. And as it says in the reading of Ramsho, it's one of the reasons why Our Lady is known as Queen of the Apostles. She brings Jesus to others. So Of course, in our prayers, this is desire of this child himself, who is not unseen. This is the beginning of her expectancy. So she's just simply looks like the 16-year-old she was a few days before. So Elizabeth doesn't see that she's with child. She knows that she is married, but she doesn't know that she's with child already. And yet, filled with the Holy Spirit, she's the one who exclaims, "How is it that the mother of my Lord should come to me? Blessed are you among all women, and blessed is the fruit of your womb." So she is obviously given to be, it's revealed to her, of this presence of the Messiah. The presence of Christ in this household, completely invisible. So it is also part of the mystery of the visitation, of the mystery of grace. Things that we don't see, the way that we are transformed because of the Spirit of God and His presence. And we also have that beautiful reference last week to this presence that Our Lady is carrying is the Gospel, the good tidings of God. So this child that she's conceived is acknowledged by Elizabeth at least in his messianic dignity, invisible though he was, or perhaps even his divinity. How is it that the mother of my Lord Adonai should come to me? So it is a very short story, but one which is filled with really the essence of what it is for us to be Christian. Touched by the hand of God's love, transformed by His grace, filled by His Spirit, and then drawn upward, not just simply up, but upward, towards the Sacred Heart, towards this infinite charity of God. And of course, the section that follows after, that I just want to leave you with to encourage you to go and look up the first chapter of St. Luke in the Gospel, and read the magnificent canticle of Our Lady of Thanksgiving, which we refer to with its first word in Latin, Magnificat. My soul extols the divinity of my Lord, my Savior who has redeemed me. This whole act of effusive gratitude, which is the response to Elizabeth's transformation by grace. She praises the Blessed Virgin, and the Blessed Mother of God immediately deflects any praise to her, and she extols God. She proclaims the magnificence of God who has looked upon her lowliness. And so it actually goes on for the next 10 verses. I encourage you to go and find it, read it, read it through today, and I would encourage you to read it through each day this week. It'll take 30 seconds. But it is an attitude of thanksgiving, of gratitude, and recognition that everything that we have comes from God. It is beautiful. In fact, it is so beautiful that the Church of the Visitation has a walled-in courtyard area, and the church is a double church. The church above, the upper floor, has altars all around the place. And it has paintings commemorating great miracles of the Mother of God throughout history. Lepanto, things that took place in other places in Europe, Lourdes, these paintings are all around this church. They're glorious. But down below, as often happens in the ancient churches, it encompasses the house of Ayin Karim. So that when you go in this church, off to the side of the altar, there's a well, which was clearly outside the house at one point, now is inside the church. And there's a huge boulder on the side also. We'll come back to that around the days of Christmas, why that church has that disposition of Ayin Karim. But encouraging you to read this canticle of the Mother of God, of the Magnificat, that courtyard area has done in sections, in ceramic tile, the Magnificat, that prayer of 10 verses, 8 verses, translated into 54 different languages, is inscribed in section after section after section around this whole courtyard of the church. It is stunningly beautiful. It is a very peaceful place, and it is a very magnificent mystery of grace that we celebrate today. May the intercession of the Mother of God Obtain for us also hearts filled with gratitude, who know that they have been touched by the grace of God, and who desire to be touched even further and transformed by the Spirit of God, so that we ourselves may reflect that gratitude of the Magnificat and follow in the footsteps of the Mother of God. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. We believe in one God, the Father Almighty,
Maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only God, Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father.
Our brothers and sisters, both living and dead.
those of Richard and Lyons. Remember also all those who share with us today in this offering.
Give thanks to the Lord with reverence and worship.
cherubim bless you, and the seraphim worship you. They cry out and they proclaim. Church employs you and through you and with you employs. because of them.
We praise you, we bless you, we adore you, we glorify you, we profess our faith in you, and we ask you, have compassion on us, O God, have mercy on us and hear us.
How awesome is this moment, O my beloved, for the living Holy Spirit descend and rest upon this offering for our sanctification. Let us stand with reverence as we pray.
Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
O God the Father, you accept prayers and answer petitions. You taught us through your beloved Son to stand before you, and to call upon you with pure souls and clear consciences, praying, Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Deliver us, O Lord, from every temptation and from harm of evil. For you have power over all, and we raise glory to you now and forever. Peace be with you.
And with your spirit.
Bow your heads before the God of mercy, before his forgiving altar, and before the body and blood of our Savior, who gives life to those who partake of him, and receive the blessing
of you. O Lord, in your grace and abundant mercy, bless those who bow before you. Make us worthy to share in your life-giving mysteries and to join the assembly of your saints that with them we may raise glory to you, to your only Son, to your Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
The grace of the Most Holy Trinity, eternal and consubstantial, be with you, my brothers and sisters, forever.
And
with your spirit. Let each one of us God with reverence and humility, and ask him for mercy and compassion.
Holy gifts for the holy, with perfection, purity, and sanctity.
One Holy Father, one Holy Son, one Holy Spirit, blessed be the name of the Lord, for it is one way in heaven and on earth, to give you the glory forever. Make us worthy, O Lord God, so that our bodies may sanctify thy holy body, and our souls purified by your living blood. May our union be with the forgiveness of our sins and for one life. O Lord our God, to you be glory forever.
Thank you.
Gracious God and Father, how can we repay you for your goodness and for the salvation you have just given us? Who can give you the glory you truly deserve? In our weakness and insofar as we are able, we worship, praise, and thank you, your only Son and your Holy Spirit, now and forever. Amen. Peace be with you. Jesus Christ, our God, we worship, thank, and praise you. We implore your goodness and abundant mercy for the salvation of the whole world, for the protection of the living and eternal rest of the departed, for the feeding of the hungry and the support of the needy, for the visiting of the sick and the consolation of the grieving. Through your grace, dwell in them, and by your abundant mercy, give them life. By your cross, bless your people and protect your inheritance. Adoration is due to you, to your Father, and to your holy and life-giving Spirit, now and forever. Go in peace, my beloved brothers and sisters, with the nourishment and blessings you have received from the forgiving altar of the Lord. May the blessing of the Most Holy Trinity accompany you, Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, the one God, to whom be glory forever.
Amen.